We'll call this today's meeting to order of the IID, that the date is June 25th, 2013, and the time is approximately 9 minutes after 1 o'clock. Would you please stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
Face the flag.
Ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Simmons, do we have any actions that were taken and closed to be reported?
No, we don't, Mr. President.
Board, this takes us to the approval of the agenda. You've all had time to review the agenda. Do you have any comments, discussions, or items you want polled or moved?
Is there a possibility we can move item 30 up to the front of save to where 21's at on the information?
Okay, on the information agenda, we're going to move item 30 to be the first item discussed under information. Staff is in the room, Mr. Kelly, to hear that, or are they waiting to come in?
We'll make sure Mr. Fillmore's here.
Okay, so moving item 30 to the beginning to take the place of item 21 for information. Any other requests in regards to the agenda?
Make a motion to approve.
We have a motion from Director Hanks to approve the agenda. Is there a second?
I'll second.
And a second from Director Kuhn. Call for the vote to accept the agenda as amended by moving item 30 to the beginning of the information section. Call for the vote. Okay, agenda is approved 4-0. And we'll be dealing with item 30, the on-farm efficiency conservation program update, at the beginning of the information section. This is a time for public comments. If you have a public comment, please come to the podium.
No, it's okay.
Mr. Ramos.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. President. You know, growing up in Calexico, California, I never knew that there was, and I'm going to be frank, prejudice or racism. And I only mean use that as a point of reference until I went into service, you know. I think I said this before, that I was ordered to go to Aiken, South Carolina, and I was more afraid to go to Aiken, South Carolina than to go to Vietnam back then, because there was more trouble in Aiken in the South than there was in Vietnam. Anyway, I went there, and believe me, I was treated with indifference. Even the supervisor that I reported to that day when I got to South Carolina, he looked at me like up like that, and he said, "What are you, Indian?" You know, instead of greeting me, he thought I was Indian. Whether what I was or not, it doesn't matter, but that's the way I was treated. Young guy, 20 years old, I didn't know right from wrong when it comes to those type of issues. I figured, what the heck am I getting into? But you know one thing I learned, a man that lived there told me, Tony, don't take it personal, don't judge him, learn from it, and that's what I did. And that's why when I come here, Mr. President, I feel so strong about equal justice, about open speech, about fairness, because I don't want to feel that this board or the people here hate me for how I look or what I say. Because if you can't make your bed and sleep, when you make your bed, you sleep in it, and in politics, you better know what you're doing. If you're too thick, thin skin, hey, you better not even go into the political arena. And that's why I feel the way I do. When I said something about my good friend Bruce, I still my friend, I don't care what I've said about him and what he said about me. Because he's still a man, he's got family like I do. And when it comes to what you did 2 weeks ago about the issue, about coming here and putting up signs, I felt, well, let's see what happened. And at least Mr. Simmons had the courage here to tell me, you know, I can put him up there, and I'm glad he did. I found a friend in him because he at least came approach me positively, and he shook my hand for serving my country. You know, I like that in people because I get goosebumps. You know, when people tell me, hey, the hat, or they say something, and thank you for serving my country. So I'm not a troublemaker. What I believe in is equal justice, equal representation. And I believe, then I go back again, so I only got about 30 seconds, that the QSA failed. I mean, the QSA was validated. Don't go there no more. Don't pay the farmers their monies because they don't deserve it. I feel that by doing that, the people will benefit. All of us will benefit. Because if we were to bust the QSA, the people would get busted too. And with this, I'll end that Mr. Simmons told me the next time I need a little more time, I mean, I can go through him to ask you, Mr. President, give me a couple of more minutes like you've done the others. There's nothing wrong with it. There's no 10,000 people waiting in line. There's only one other person. And again, I want to thank you. God bless America. I'm very proud to have served my country. And there's no other country like America, believe me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Ramos.
Tony, I just, so you know, I also have a DD-214. Good. As does Al Kalin. I don't, where's he at? There he is. I know he does. Pardon? Department of Defense Honorable Discharge. And damn, I was glad to get it.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, President Desert and IID board members. I'm Kay Day Percola, Executive Director of CoLab Imperial Valley. I come before you today to note concerns relative to the action item numbered 11, engagement agreement with two public outreach firms. This placement as an agenda item seems to be in conflict of the May 14, 2013 approved policies 3101 and 3130. The intent is defined in the general manager's 2013 scope of work, first presented to the board December 18th, 2012, and then approved at the IID board meeting April 23rd, 2013, was to enlist internal and external resources to form a communication council. Is this proposed contracts or contracts to meet that piece of the scope of work? If so, is this action a disregard of the policy and procedure so adeptly crafted by the IID staff to the benefit of the public? It cannot be considered an emergency item. The scope of work was identified as early as 7 months ago, so the lack of time is not the reason. The next question is, who identified these two firms, and are they the best for the task? Was it staff through the established process, a board member, or the new legal team? Whoever found them may be applauded once the work is completed, and if it is done within the stated 6 months. All of us recognize that an improvement in public perception of IID is needed, both in Imperial Valley and throughout the country. Indeed, IID may be compared, since it is baseball season, to the overwhelmed Houston Astros. But to attempt to slide to first base with this one is unnecessary. I could use other sports metaphors like walks, strikes, home runs, and even outs, but this is not a game. Even water districts like sports franchises are businesses and should be run as a business. IID needs to be run as a business, not someone's personal game board. Thank you.
Any other comments from the public? Not seeing any. We'll turn this over to board members for comments. We'll start this afternoon with Director Kuhn.
I would only like to say that we have a team, several people. There's like 10 of them on the All-American Canal as we speak, looking for the young man that disappeared, and they've been there. We got there Monday after Father's Day, but I was contacted Sunday on Father's Day by John Renison and then by Luis Castro from Calexico, and they were frustrated, didn't seem like anything was getting done. And I guess you couldn't get a more serious day to have something like that dropped on you. Father's Day, I mean, I'm celebrating it with my family, and this kid has a father, and his son was in the canal. He shouldn't have been in there, but doesn't change. So it was pretty serious timing. So I got a hold of General Manager Kelly, and he actually went down and met with the family Sunday, Father's Day. And I commend him for that, because that needed to be done. And by Monday, J.R. Hatfield of our emergency service headquarters had put together a team, and they were scouring that canal in a boat with vehicles. They even procured a helicopter to take him over. And the effort has been Herculean. Unfortunately, we have not found his body, but it isn't because we didn't try, and it isn't because we didn't care, because we've been out there and late into the nights on some nights. And I just want to say thank you, Kevin, for what you got done. And if you do see JR and everybody else out there, give them a personal thank you from me and perhaps from you, because I'm not a deeply religious man. I leave that to my wife. But I will say this, they're out there doing God's work.
Thank you, Director Kuhn. Director Hanks?
I can't follow that up. It says it all.
Director Benson?
I just want to reiterate for Damian Placencia's family, we do feel for your loss, and the IID canals are not a safe place to go swimming. I often kick people out of canals now that I'm in a director position. I used to just wave to people in the canals, but I think it's important that everybody knows that. We do have the Dippy Duck program that has received criticism in the past, but I think it's an energized program, and it's good getting out to all the schools. We also are talking about ways that we might be able to increase the age group that we really go after, and it's the older kids that are the ones that are probably at greater risk, because even though that they think they know how to swim, some of those canals are not safe. Secondly, I just wanted to follow up on a couple trips I took recently. I went to Nashville with Carl Stills to the APPA conference. That's the American Public Power Association. We took a couple classes, or at least I did. A lot of it was focused on training board members, new board members. So monitoring our financials, the utility performance, and it was all power related. The legal and governing roles of board members. And it's pretty consistent across the United States that public power is at risk, in the sense that a lot of private utilities are gaining strength. Recently, Duke and Progress just joined in the eastern United States. They're now the nation's largest utility. There's also Edison on our side, and then Mid-America just purchased Nevada Energy, which is a private concern in Nevada. So, you know, it always came back to the business model of public power and why we're in the business. Even though we are an irrigation district, power is a spinoff of that irrigation function. And we serve an area larger than ours. It's pretty common for public power to reach outside your scope of, you start in a city, then you start reaching out to adjoining areas. But really, we're a customer-focused group, in the sense that customer service is important to us, as evidenced by the recent outage a couple of years ago when our power was on first and the rest of California was still dark. There's people on the line that can talk to you, that know your community, that live in the community. And one of the big complaints of these large power companies is that you're calling someone in another region or another state or another country even. And they're just outsourcing everything. So we're trying to keep jobs local and keep everyone with their lights on. The last thing that I did was yesterday, actually. I'm on the California Farm Water Coalition, and it's a group of irrigation districts throughout California. We usually meet in Sacramento, but we're starting to do tours of different regions. And this was actually a tour of the Metropolitan Water District's Diamond Valley Reservoir. It's an 800,000 acre foot reservoir. It represents 6 months of the supply for LA as an emergency service. It's something that was built over 10 years ago and actually is a great accomplishment. It was a $2 billion project. When I was an engineer at Parsons, we actually worked on it, so it was good to see it. When I worked there, we looked at the plans, but 20 years later, it actually got built and it's functioning. And then we looked at a reclamation facility. A lot of the Los Angeles water districts actually also serve a sewer function, and they're starting to reuse a lot of their water. And it's just amazing the amount of reuse that's going on in other areas. This was Eastern Municipal, which is Paris, Hemet, the Moreno Valley area. And they're actually reusing about 30,000 out of 50,000 acre feet of sewer water. So a lot of that goes on to farm ground, which some would say was controversial, but it gets blended and it is treated so it's clean. Also, it has higher nitrates and higher phosphates, which helps on the farming, especially alfalfa. That's all I have right now. Thanks.
That was started out as Dominigoni, didn't it?
Yeah, until the Dominigoni family sued.
Thank you, Director Benson, and thank you for representing the IID so well on your travels and reporting back of your activities and the information that we need to hear. I just got a couple items, too, specifically. One, I heard the comments in public from CoLab and the Veg Growers Association in regards to the communications firms being hired by the IID, and there's been much discussion in that area by this board, by the private community and the public, and more specifically with the ag community. And I'll just look to the general manager, if you could do that, Kevin, if you could give a better answer as to how we got to where we're at, so you can speak for the IID. And finally, I'd just like to recognize the family of Damien Plasencia. Damien, a terrible loss, and the concern of this board from being the IID board, but also from being individual members of the community and with families of our own. I'd like to also speak for Director Galindo and her concerns. I was on communication with her daily about this issue, trying to keep up on it and give better updates as to what's happening. So that's all I have at this time for my comments. Mr. Kelly, you have comments?
Yes, President Desert, members of the board, I'll respond to the public comment, the remarks that were given by Ms. Percola when that item comes up for your consideration. On the first matter of the recovery effort, I do want to acknowledge the a continuing contribution of the Water Department, both in terms of overtime and resources, and from your own board in allowing those resources to be expended. You will hear from Mr. Hatfield today with a status report on the activities over this last week, which sadly have not produced the desired outcome. And it may very well be that our activity level will become less pronounced in the days ahead. But we won't stop trying to complete that recovery effort. And I too am greatly saddened at the at that family's loss.
Mr. Simmons?
I have no comments, Mr. President.
Okay, thank you. Board, this moves us into the consent area of the agenda. For the record, I'll read the 9 items on the consent calendar to Dan. Item 1 is approval of the board minutes for May 28th and June 11th of 2013. Item 2 is acknowledge receipt of director's expenses report for period ending May 27th, 2013. Item 3 is ratification of the general manager's employment agreement. Item 4 is approval of power sales agreements with Southern California Public Power Authority for the Heber 1 geothermal energy project. Item 5, approval for staff to award bid number 12-09R as a 3-year alliance agreement to One Source Distributors on behalf of Siemens Industry to supply circuit breakers to the IID. Item 6, approval for staff to award bid number 12-18 as a three-year alliance agreement to One Source Distributors on behalf of Southern California States LLC to supply disconnect switches. Item 7, approval of amendment number 10, the ID open access transmission tariff covering small generators interconnections. Item 8, approval of amendment number 4 to service agreement number 81-1049 to extend Allied Waste existing agreement for 3 months. And finally, item 9 on the consent agenda, adopt resolution declaring transformers and miscellaneous items as surplus and authorizing their disposal. Do I have a motion to approve the consent calendar as presented?
So moved.
We have a motion from Director Kuhn. Is there a second?
I'll second.
And a second from Director Hanks. Call for the vote. Okay, consent calendar with 9 items read into the record have passed 4-0. This moves us into the action area of the agenda. Next up, we have action item 10. Is an internal audits general matters report, page 49 of the agenda today. And presenting is Betty V.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good afternoon, members of the board. I will give a short update on the local entity non-competitive award winners audited list and the we're going to audit the way we come up with the list. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer. On May 28, the local entity's final disbursement was approved by the board. There were a total of 41 applicants and was awarded $5.2 million. The largest award was over $603,000, and the smallest award was for $462. We will audit the top 15 recipients, and that means every single award that is above $137,000. This will represent 75% of the total dollars awarded. After today's meeting, tomorrow morning, the first thing, if we have agreement from the board, and if you don't have any changes for us to make, we are ready to send out the engagement letters to everybody and let them know to introduce our audit objectives to them. So if you have any questions at this time, I would I'm ready to give you to respond.
You did do one on it, right?
We did look into one audit, and that will be reported out to the board and to the public at the same time when we finish the other 14.
Okay.
It's going to be one report, so therefore we don't want to report only on one. We'll do one report for all 15, so we could do that at the same time.
So, Betty,
go ahead, Steve.
The audit sample, you say you do 4 out of the top?
We did top 15. The last page you have here, just these are the non-competitive winners that we will be auditing. And I have, for the public, if anybody desires, I have a printout on the side table. These are going to be the farm service providers that we going to be auditing. And it's almost close to $4 million, okay, which is 75%. The last page, I have a last page here just for comparison, that the methodology that we used in 2010, and at that time we audited 54% of the total awards. So I just put that in for comparison.
Okay, thanks.
Board, any questions for Betty? Thank you, Betty.
Thank you.
Next up is action item 11. This is an engagement agreement with two public outreach firms, APCO Worldwide Inc. and Diversity Consulting Group LLC. This is item is located on page 50 of the agenda, and presenting today will be our general manager, Mr. Kevin Kelly.
Yes, President Desert, members of the board, IID's had a sort of mixed history with outside communications firms when it has retained firms from the outside. And by the outside, I mean major markets. Those engagements have not turned out well, and they haven't had longevity. So it's kind of a mixed bag for IID to wade into this this area. But the Salt and Sea Initiative that your board is embarking on is going to be a rough one, and it's going to take legal, technical, scientific, and yes, communications expertise that that doesn't reside within the district. In my tenure here at IID as general manager, I've resisted the call that's been fairly steady for a couple of years that IID ought to get some professional help on the communications front. I do have some background in this area. I always felt like we didn't have a communications problem so much as a problem. I don't think that's the case anymore. I think that we do need outside help from experts, and the two firms represented here are ones that I picked out on your behalf. It was not to flout or circumvent our bidding policy, our revised bidding policy. Rather, it was run through the general counsel's office in the same way that the two firms that are heading up your QSA litigation effort are run through the general counsel's office. These are on a project basis for 6 months. If they were to be extended, and I'm not suggesting they should be, it would be a decision your board would make. The reason 6 months is the mark is because for the balance of 2013, if we don't get some traction on what we're trying to do at the Salton Sea, if we can't establish the nexus between a viable water transfer agreement and a viable restoration plan at the Salton Sea, then you could very well end up in a legal dispute. So it's going to take a concerted effort by an integrated team. It isn't without cost, and it's going to take something very much like what I'm proposing here. I have great confidence in these two firms. I knew from the start that we needed a firm based in Sacramento because San Diego and Los Angeles were problematic for us. The regional firm that's assisting is based in Santa Barbara, but has some local connections, and the particular expertise with diversity is that it does Spanish language and has brand marketing with stakeholder groups. So I attended a meeting with both firms last week. I believe that they're ready to go, and I think that you will be in the best position to judge how effective they've been based on how we're able to fight for this initiative that could determine the future of our region. So if you have specific questions about what's proposed here, I'll try to respond to them. I do want you to know that both Munger Tolles and Mr. DeMars endorsed the retainer of these two firms. And your board has been involved in the selection process.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly. Board, any questions for Kevin?
I'd just like to make a couple of comments. You know, we all read the papers and we see that the Bay Delta project is up front and center in the state of California, and the Salton Sea is a forgotten commodity. And we can't allow that to happen. I think that certain players up and down the state would probably like for that to happen. Just let this everybody go to sleep and let the sea become a problem for the Imperial Valley. Likewise, with the term limits, every year there's a large number of freshman legislatures, and from the information and feedback I get, I've been receiving, there's some question in my mind that they even know that they have an obligation to meet their funding obligation on the Salton Sea. Another area that we have to hit hard. I just would encourage you with the diversity group, particularly when they're working up in the Coachella Valley, that they include the value of the IID energy in that area. I think that'll be helpful to the IID. And then just like to mention what you said right towards the end there. These teams are working in collaboration with our legal team. It is all part of a long-term strategy moving forward and implementation of the QSA. Some say, well, you don't fight the validation. Well, that's in the judge's hand, and that's not going to be the issue here soon. What's going to be an issue is the implementation and whether the QSA is going to be met by all parties, including the Salton Sea, or whether it's going to be established as an illusory promise. And if that's the case, then we have to have strategy in place, and our legal team be prepared to react to that. Thank you.
Any other comments, board?
I would just like to say I've met with both firms, and I think they have a lot of good experience, not only knowledge of our issues, but in general, how the state works and how crisis works in this state. Right now, the crisis is the Bay Delta. If you talk to anyone north of Los Angeles, that's all they can talk about. It's north versus south, upper Sacramento versus south Sacramento. LA's caught in the middle, and there's a bunch of farmers that are out of water. We're really no different down here. We're south of LA, and then there's LA north and across the ocean, or by the ocean, sorry. I think we just need to create a higher profile for ourselves outside of our region. I think we need to think bigger picture, that it's not only what we think in our region, it's what others think. And there's a lot of people knocking on doors every day that have their own vested interest in mind, and we need to be communicating as well. Secondly, I think it's important that we really push the renewable component of the Salton Sea area, the IID as a resource for the region, to really be the gatekeeper of renewable energy, if you will. We have a lot of resources here, and if it can benefit our community, that's great. We don't want to do anything that hurts our community. Many have said the water transfer hurts our community. Well, I agree. It does provide, although some money for the IID to do conservation work, the future is uncertain, and the time will tell in the next 4 years of my term what gets resolved on the QSA. And all we can do as public officials is set policy and manage the general manager to get the job done. So our goal is to do that.
Yeah. Thank you, Director Benson. Any other comments, board? I'll turn it over to the public. The public has comments.
Thank you, Mr. President and the board. My name is Mark Grand. I own a local business called Strictly Business. It's a consulting and real estate firm. And one of the things I do is governmental and community relations work. And so I'm also on the vendor list for the IID. And so I was surprised to see this on the agenda, and there had been no RFP taken out. So I came to the board and found out that there wasn't an RFP put out, which maybe I wouldn't have been qualified, maybe, but the community relations effort in the local area, who better to do it than a local business down here that's has the connections with everybody down here. I'm an elected official, as you are. I know all of you. I know the other elected officials. There's other businesses here that have been in public relations firms down here that know this local area. We may not have the size as some of these big firms, but it would have been nice to have the opportunity to be able to bid on the project and offer our services down here, because certainly we know this area. We know what the problems are. And certainly we could help the IID resolve those issues with the community. So I hope if this goes forward, I hope in the future after the 6 months is over that there's an opportunity for us to be able to bid on the project. And I hope these firms, if they get selected, are willing to work with the local people and local firms down here that can give them that tie-in with the community. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Grant. Any other comments from the public?
If I could, just to Mr. Grand's point, in the case of both these firms, I expect that they will actually visit here in the Imperial Valley, even here in the summer when it's hot. Their specific charge is to help IID to break through the clutter that we're going to encounter at every level of state government in trying to move our initiative forward. And just so that people, you know, understand this, the first job is to make people care about the Salton Sea. The second is to actually make people care enough to agree to our initiative. And the third would be to actually have it built out where we had a viable Salton Sea. That will be, as Mr. DeMars has said, that will be a tough slog. And I know that that Mr. Grand and many of the others that are involved in traditional public relations, public affairs work locally are highly competent. They don't have a shop in Sacramento, and this really is a unique fit and a unique circumstance. I do believe, though, that if I'm wrong and in 6 months' time we have spent this money in vain, you certainly can hold me accountable for it, and you can discontinue this engagement.
Mr. Kalin?
Al Kalin, Westmoreland. I was reading one of the statements here from the Diversity Consulting Group, and it lining out what they understand as the problem. And one of the things they mentioned, the New River and its negative impacts on the Salton Sea and conversely on the existing agricultural land. I guess I have a problem with that. Wonder why they said the New River. The Alamo is much bigger, and puts far more nutrients, which is the only thing that pollutes the sea, from the two rivers of any consequence. Makes me wonder if maybe they need to do some more homework. And I think they need to talk to local people that have some knowledge on that. As far as I know, the New River, where it enters the sea, the water quality is not much different than that from canal water, except it's saltier, and it has more nutrients. But that's it.
Yeah, I think, Al, that the reason that that's in there is that there's going to end up being some sort of environmental justice component to the campaign that these two firms institute, and I believe that they've been in touch with the New River proponents in Calexico on the front end. I would agree with you that that's awkwardly included, and I expect that they'll be talking to you.
Thank you.
Any further comments from the public? We'll bring it back to the board for action. Any further discussion, board?
I would just like to say that I would like to see this communication council established with local participants. We do have a number of local people that are not only electeds, but in the communication business as well. Mr. Grand, one of them. But I think that it's important that we get the message out internally within our own community. Using outside help is great, but we can't do it as board members as effectively as other people that care about the same issues as we do. So
I think that that's actually a really good segue. At the end of the day, I would hope heading into the end of summer, if not before then, IID and Imperial County and hopefully others are going to be approaching non-governmental organizations, city councils, chambers of commerce in both valleys, and we're going to be asking everybody to sign on to this initiative, our particular vision of what restoration ought to mean at the Salton Sea. And the best way to do that would be to form a local group of people with that specific skill set, and use it as a bully pulpit.
Okay, thanks.
Well, board, do we have a motion to approve this engagement agreement between these two outreach firms?
I'll make a motion to approve.
We have a motion from Director Hanks. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Second from Director Benson. Any further discussion? Call for the vote. Item passes 4-0. Next up, action item 12, a request by Imperial County Office of Education to sponsor educational workshop luncheon, page 77 of the agenda. And presenting today is Jennifer Goodsell.
Good afternoon, President Desert, members of the board. IID received a request from the Imperial County Office of Education to sponsor a luncheon at the Old Eucalyptus Schoolhouse in August, featuring nationally renowned educational speaker Ken Kay. The goal of the event is to involve the business community in the discussion of a strategic plan that reflects the business community's expectations for a prepared workforce moving forward and the subsequent knowledge and skills that students will need to possess as a result. The donation amount being requested is $5,000, and Mr. Arnold Preciado, Assistant Superintendent for ICOE, is here this afternoon to say a few words and answer any questions you might have.
Welcome, Mr. Preciado.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, Imperial Irrigation District Board of Directors, Mr. Kevin Kelly, Mr. Ross Simmons. My name is Arnold Preciado. I'm Assistant Superintendent of Business for Imperial County Office of Education. I'm here today representing Mrs. Ann Mallory, who is the Superintendent of the Office of Education, but unfortunately she is not able to be here today and sends her greetings and her regrets. The item before you is a request for a sponsorship and support of an important meeting between local business owners, public officials, and school district boards. The purpose of our meeting is to better understand the workforce needs within our community and address the challenges that our students have in terms of preparing them for the future. To head this meeting, we will have Mr. Ken Kay, CEO of Ed Leader 21, which is a professional learning community for education leaders committed to 21st century learning. Mr. Kay will provide insight and knowledge on how to best meet workforce needs and ensure that the education and of our children will prepare them for their future. This will help us to develop a plan to meet the needs of our business community here locally. We thank the Imperial Irrigation District for being a vital and key partner on the P16 Council, which is again a collaboration of educational leaders and business community folks working together to better prepare students for the workforce in a challenging and changing world. We ask the board for its consideration on this matter, and I'll be happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Any questions today from Mr. Preciado?
Is that a morning meeting or a lunch,
Tina? No, this is a luncheon here. There's okay. Also a morning meeting with the educational leaders of Imperial County as well with Mr. Kay. Yes. So he's going to be here for just about the whole day.
Is there any way you can get our meeting canceled that day and then we can go?
I think that'd be up to someone else.
Right. Questions? Do we have a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve.
Oh, we have a motion from Director Benson to approve.
Are they going to send us a lunch over? Yeah. I'll second the motion.
Motion from Director Benson and a second from Director Hanks. Any further discussion?
No, I just, you know, I'm aware of the P16 Council. I was part of that group that helped form it. And it is a great opportunity locally for us to grow our own leadership. And no greater place starting with these youngsters.
How many of these youngsters are going to be here, be at this thing?
Actually, Mr. K is going to be presenting to the business community folks, as well as with the board. We'll have a luncheon meeting. That's the request here before you. But in the morning, going back to Mr. Benson's statement and question, we will be having a meeting with Mr. K in the morning with the educational leaders of the county, and then move towards a joint meeting with the business community at noon at Old Eucalyptus to discuss some of the challenges, some of the needs of our workforce. What is it that we need in the business community to educate in terms of education and in educating our students to meet their needs? It's going to be a very important meeting.
Okay, so in this particular day, you're going to educate the educators. They'll go back and educate the kids.
we need to hear firsthand what we need here locally to meet the business community's needs.
It's basically to align the curriculum with the business community.
I got it.
Okay, motion from Director Benson and a second from Director Hanks. Further discussion? Call for the vote. Item passes 4-0.
Thank you.
Next up is action item 13, approval of amendment to service agreement with David Nahai Consulting Services. Page 80 of the agenda, and Mr. Kelly will be presenting on this.
Yes, President Desert, members of the board, I actually would ask that you defer taking action on this item today. I'd prefer that you wait and have a full board. Director Galindo, when we were last in Sacramento, did meet with Mr. Nahai, and he mentioned that he could be of some assistance to IID in a facet of the renewable energy initiative that is part of the Salton Sea proposal. And I believe that we would do well to wait until your board meets next to act on this item so that he can fulfill that request.
Make a motion to table to the next meeting.
Motion to table.
I'll second that.
Second from Benson. Call for the vote. Item passes 4-0 to table this item to the next meeting or the next meeting when we have a full board present. Next up is action item 14, request by the Imperial County Farm Bureau for contribution to its total maximum dissolved load program, page 83 of the agenda. And presenting today is Jesse Silva.
Good afternoon, board members. As you're aware, IID has been funding the Farm Bureau's TMDL program for drains. We budgeted $160,000 this year for this as a part of this request. And I had thought that it covered, the previous action the board took covered this full year, but it was only 12 months, which was beginning last July 1st to this June 30th. So that's why we're back here today asking you for approval of this item. We also have the, I think I saw, there she is, Lindsay. If you have any questions regarding this program or any other questions, Lindsay's here to answer any questions.
So this request here today, this item, is for an extension of this program through December 31st of 2013?
Yes. Later on in the information agenda, we'll be hearing from the Regional Water Quality Control Board regarding their new plans that they have. And so we wanted to kind of fund this through the end of this year, and then at the end of this year, as we get we learn more about that another program, budget for whatever we're going to do the following year. So that's why we're asking at least to fund it through the end of the year.
Mm-hmm. Mrs. Dale?
As you know, this program was originally funded through State Water Resources Board Prop 50 grants. That's when we started the program back in 2000. Since then, those grants have gone away. IID graciously stepped in to continue this program. And you know the importance of our TMDL program. It's working hand in hand between the farmers, the IID, and the Regional Water Control Board. The program costs us $160,000 to run each year. Farm Bureau is a nonprofit agency to fund this. We did for a little while. It was very difficult, so we're looking for the funding to continue from IID. We do know that the future is uncertain on the TMDL program in the respect, as Jose will be explaining to you in a future item today. The program will be changing. We don't know what changes, how that's going to impact us completely. We do know that there will be a fee charged from the State Water Resources Board, and at that time we're going to need to make some decisions on how IID and Farm Bureau can continue this program and work together possibly. So the funding request will be able to get us through to that point when we start charging and have some changes made. We've made a request for a year funding, $160,000. I mean, Jesse has it for $80,000. Of course, we'd like to extend that if possible so we don't have to come back in another 6 months. So, any questions?
Lindsay, if we fund this through December 31st, won't that coincide with the new year and the new program that we're going to hear more about later today?
Well, the timeline that Jose has shown to us, and it may be different, and he can explain that a little later, that the CEQA process will begin sometime at the end of this year in 2013, and we won't see anything, you know, in the works going until possibly September 2014. That's the earliest date that we will see things moving forward or in place at that time. So it is a process. We have to go through the CEQA process. We still need to review the proposal from the regional board, which has not been completed. We're waiting for the completion of Bard, Palo Verde, and Coachella's TMDL, or their conditional waiver, as ours is being proposed. So there's a lot of different factors playing into the timing.
So the request was for $160,000, which is a year, which would take us through actually a year from today to the June of 2014.
It would go July 1st through June 30th.
Mm-hmm. And the additional program requirements that kick in 2014, are those going to be additional expenses?
The proposal, currently the proposal is there's three different tiers. Tier one would be Farm Bureau or a coalition being in place similar to what we have now, and that coalition being authorized to collect the funds from the growers at 56 cents per acre, per grower, per year. That is the proposal as it's in place now. That money all goes to the state. Nothing stays here. So I don't know if we are going to be required to charge a little bit more. We need to have some discussions on that. That's the current proposal, although I just received word recently that that will be increased to 83 cents. They're already talking about increasing that 56 cents per acre to 83. So by the time we get it, it's probably going to be more.
Sounds like we may be able to jointly use a communications firm to get this message out to all the farmers.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a difficult pill to swallow. We've been under a conditional prohibition for a very long time. That program was working. We were very successful. We thought it would continue, but with the disapproval of Palo Verde's conditional prohibition back about a year and a half ago from the State Water Resources Board, kind of pushed us into that conditional waiver.
Lindsay, are you asking for us to fund for a full year, or are you asking us to fund for a half year to align with the IID budget cycle?
Well, we're asking for the continuance of a full year. Last year, we were granted July 1st through June 30th, and so we're asking for that again as well.
Jesse, I have a question. Why wouldn't we fund the full year if this new process isn't coming online?
Well, it's just a budget issue. So I have it budgeted for this total year. And then the budget cycle, what I wanted to do is budget again, and then hopefully we'll know a little bit more about what else we need to fund and then bring to you a budget that includes all of that. So it's just a matter of process. You could approve a full year, and we'll just include it in the budget, but then we have to come back to you and add whatever other issues, programs come up.
If we add it for the whole year, you'd still be bringing the budget forward with it. So
I'd
prefer to see Lindsay every 6 months in front of us. So.
Thank you. I don't know if that's a compliment or not.
Okay, do we have a motion board?
Well, $80,000 is 3 cents an acre foot.
Yes. We run on a very streamlined budget at the Farm Bureau, trust me.
Well, for everybody here, first things first, I mean, you know, this was not something that we volunteered to do. It's, ooh, the boss is here. Anyway, I'll step down in a second. Anyway, she's buying a house and she's all excited.
Go write the check.
Oh, you got it. Oh, God. Okay. Anyway, this thing is serious, and if it's not taken care of, it's going to come back and bite us, and it'll cost us a hell of a lot more than $160,000. Mark my word.
What's your motion? You already made the motion.
I'll make a motion for $160,000.
I'll second that.
Motion from Director Benson and a second from Director Kuhn. Any further discussion? Call for the vote. Item passes 4-0.
Thank you. We appreciate it. And for the record, I'm still in the back row every single week, so thank you.
Next up, we have the action item 15, approval of feed-in tariff effective July 1st, 2013 to comply with Senate Bill 1332, page 86 of your agenda. And presenting today is Belen Valenzuela.
For her to present without a overhead. I did like her to present one time.
Yes, I brought this item as information to the board in May. And anyway, so it's just a follow-up. There was a couple changes that were made since it was made presented as an informational item. But just to go over quickly, it's just basically Senate Bill 32 is requiring all publicly owned utilities that have more than 75,000 retail electric customers to offer its renewable, offer a feed-in tariff rate to its renewable generating customers. And so the whole goal is to meet a statewide cumulative capacity of 750 megawatts, of which a megawatt limit. So of that, the way they're doing it is they're computing what the proportionate share is of each utility within the state. And the districts as of 2011 was 12. So as you can see, I put 12 to 15 megawatts of the 750 megawatts is the district's portion of that 750 megawatt limit that they want to set. So basically the feed-in tariff, when you look at it and you kind of build the rates, what you're kind of looking at is how the cost avoidance from demand reduction and the environmental attributes and avoided transmission congestion costs, as well as distribution improvement cost. So with that being said, staff with rates and us went back and looked at those rates and at the different times it would deliver it, and have developed a summer and winter rates also based on different time periods during the day. So our summer period will be May through September, and our winter is October through April, and we've also identified the on-peak and mid-peak hours as well as the off-peak, and those are the rates during that time. So they will have a these customers will have a time of use meter put on them, or we will measure what time it's generating, and we will be able to count that towards the 33% renewable portfolio standards. So that is what the rate looks like. When you average them all out, for instance, I'll give the example of a solar project, because I think that's what we have in queue right now. It averages out to about $85.90 per megawatt, is what this averages out too.
So that's the number if someone signs up and builds their own solar program and facility and then interconnects it, wants to interconnect it to our grid and feed energy into our system to help us, we would pay them $85.90 a megawatt.
Yeah, so if you average out all these rates and if you kind of model it on what a solar system, it ends up being about $85.90 a megawatt. So what we've tried to do is give them some incentive to make sure that we're also they're there for IID's peak demand times during the summertime.
Do you expect utilization by IID to be mostly off-peak hours?
No, I expect to be on peak.
On peak?
On peak, yeah. What we did is, for instance, we modeled Sun Peak. And when you look at it, the majority of the hours look like they would be between mid-peak and on-peak. So when you start looking at it, like about 1 in the afternoon, you would max out, let's say, at the 15 megawatts, and then it starts coming down.
So we're talking about 12 to 15 megawatts?
Yes.
For the year?
Yeah, right now, and I put 12 to 15. I mean, our obligation to the state is 12 megawatts as of the 2011 numbers are showing. They have not come out with the 2012 yet. But in the right now, what we have lined up, you know, just that gives them some wiggle room in case it doesn't add up to quite 12 megawatts.
Will you have time to schedule this, or is this kind of...
You take it when you get it, okay. Kind of.
That's what I was afraid of.
Yeah.
Who pays the interconnection costs? The developer or whoever's delivering?
I think when we've got it developed, they will have a deposit that they have to pay for, yes.
But we have to upgrade our system in that area in order to accommodate it, right?
Yes.
And are they going to pay those costs?
Yes. Is Jamie? Yes, they are. But
okay.
The way the tariff does read is that the utility, the load-serving entity, ourselves, that we can make sure that it gets put on somewhere where it makes sense to serve the load. So
we don't have to take it anywhere on the grid. It can be strategically located.
Yes.
Okay.
So this is a requirement that we do not have to take more than 15 megawatts under this?
Actually, we don't have to take more than 12.
12?
Yes.
All right. I'll make a motion to approve.
And we have a motion from Director Hanks. Is there a second?
I'll second.
And a second from Director Kuhn. Any further discussion?
I had a question regarding the escalation factor. Is that normal for PPAs on renewables?
Yes, they do about 1.5%. But this also, we have that escalation factor in there, 1.5%. That is normal. But we also have it in there that at any time the board, we can go back and relook at those rates and the board can redo them. So that's also in there.
Okay.
I want to kind of give you a comparison of what IID's proposed is compared to SMUD, LADWP's, Anaheim's, and Riverside's. So you'll see like LADWP, they have a delivery multiplier and all of that. But what we've done is we've taken that into consideration, and that's what it actually looks like. So if you break down LADWP's, it's like over $200 a megawatt during those 8 hours of peaking time. So I wanted to give the board. I think the way LADWPs reads, it's like 2.5 times. So you'd be looking at close to 200 megawatts during that 8 hours.
So I take it Riverside is not getting many connections in this program, right?
Exactly.
So how do they make the requirement, Riverside?
Well,
we're required up to 12 megawatts?
Yes.
You have to build up to 12 or you just have to offer the program?
You have to offer the program.
Oh, so they don't want to do the program, essentially.
Mm-hmm. So we try to at least make it incentivize them to be there when we need it. Also try to incentivize them for more solar, so that technology versus off-peak renewable resource when, you know, we don't really need it. So, and right now what you've got in queue, you think you've got over 26 megawatts. There's 10 people lined up, but out of those 10, there's only three of them that are separate entities. So.
I think the other thing for people to understand too, a lot of these areas, you couldn't do it in their location, right? They'd have to
It could not make sense if they have to transmit
it in or something. They don't have real estate per se. No.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay, we have a motion from Director Hanks and a second from Director Kuhn. Call for the vote. Item passes 4-0. Next up is action item 16, replacement of Water Conservation Committee member Mike Abadi with Al Kalin. Presenting today is Carlos Villon.
Carlos Villon, Water Department. As you're well aware, the Water Conservation Committee was created back in January to review and revise the equitable distribution plan, which was finally adopted May of this past month. During this whole period, Mr. Abadi has been a member and been working hard on that committee. He has resigned from the committee. The Farm Bureau and, of course, Water Department would like to recommend Al Kalin to replace Mr. Abadi in the Water Conservation Committee.
I make a motion to approve.
I'll second that.
A motion from Director Kuhn, a second from Director Benson. Any further discussion? Call for the vote. Item passes 4-0. Thank you, Carlos. Action item 17, acknowledge receipt of energy cost adjustment report for May of 2013.
Good afternoon,
presenting today, President. Cynthia Majanowski.
Yep. Good afternoon, President Desert, members of the board. Cindy Majanowski, Finance, with the update on the ECA. We cleaned up the presentation slightly to make it easier to follow. And with that, I'll go to slide 3, where the first item you can see that the May preliminary 4.28. to keep the rate at 324, and that brings the total balance through May to 6.35 to keep the rate at 324. And slide 4 is a recap. So in 2011, we had an over-collection balance of $38 million. In 2012, we utilized 1.99 of that. We had an under-collection. And so January to April, we've had $2 million in under collection. And May's preliminary under collection balance is 4.28, which brings us to a cumulative total on the over collection balance of 29.7.
Okay, any questions for Cynthia?
Just so I understand, we're actually ahead of, but we haven't used up as much as we thought we would, right? If you look at the previous slide, because the 5.5 was a negative.
Yeah, we originally had, I think it was January through March, we had an over collection, and then it's been under collection since then.
And then our kilowatt hour sales were actually more, so that probably made us more money, so it wasn't as big of a spread, I assume?
Yeah.
All right.
Motion to accept the ECA report as presented.
Yeah, I'd like to make a motion to accept as presented, and along with a recommendation. Could you make us just a graph with these reports to just kind of show us the use and
sure,
and kind of, you know, so yeah, we know when.
And if you also
the peak months and kind of see where we're at and project to the end.
And also next report, if they could, as Director Benson mentioned, if we could show us where we're at as we were where we were projected to be in utilizing this ECA account.
And through the end of the year too, kind of where it's going to go. It'd be nice to see it drop off.
Right now we're projecting we're pretty much going to use it by September, October.
We have a motion from Director Hanks, and I'll make the second on this item. Any further discussion?
Any comment?
Comments? Call for the vote.
Item passes.
4-0. Next up is action item 18, adopt changes to policy number 1525 covering an increased limit to the general manager to approve surplus materials. Page 94 of the agenda, and Donna Gray is presenting today.
Good afternoon, directors. As directed, have brought the revised policy for surplus disposal to the board at direction of Director Kuhn. This has been reviewed by council, and it stands before you in its reviewed state.
Mr. President, I make a motion to accept.
We have a motion from Director Kuhn to accept the policy as presented and as revised.
I'll second that.
And we have a second from Director Benson. Do we have discussion or questions?
I just wanted to make sure I understand this right, Mr. Ross. all items will have been declared surplus by the board before they are disposed of.
This policy provides approval authority granted to the general manager for the surplus items valued at $1,500 or less. Those valued, current value above that price would come to the board the way the transformers did today. Right. This would reduce the amount of
clutter.
The amount of lower dollar items that would come to the board. So in accordance with your authority, you have the authority to direct authority in your behalf.
Director Hanks, if I may, I reiterate, I did a walkthrough down there, and it's costing us more to keep that junk around than if we got rid of it. I mean, it just, I never thought it was wise to spend a dollar to save a dime. And so just, it's clutter.
But someone has to be willing to get rid of it too.
Yes, but unfortunately it's just been accumulating and
The process is that the department managers have to approve any items that come before them from their staff. So the department manager is stating that this item is surplus. Those items go to stores and are listed, and they keep a complete cradle to grave on each item. The items are listed on an authorization sheet for the general manager, currently at current value at $100 or less. And then they are disposed of in accordance with the policy. We auction them off. We sell them through our online site. If they are in bad condition, we'll destroy them. This just allows the authority level to go higher for the general manager, which speeds up the process.
Who sets the value?
They use a lot of comparables. They go on to similar auction sites and record what similar items went to as far as their sale price. That's not a guarantee that the item you have will go at the same price, but we have to try and establish an approximate value at today and in this market. So
I'm going to ask you, Ross, on number four, under the water code. I'm only asking this because of experiences in a public school system. The way I understand it, any property has to be declared surplus by the board. That was my understanding.
What was the question? That any property? So your
property.
You think that your interpretation of that section was it had to be item by item?
Yeah, we're talking about public property, and it would take the action by the board to declare it surplus before it could be disposed of.
Well, essentially, what the board is doing, and as Donna said before, there are procedures in place already from on the accounting side and on the supervision side. What the board is essentially doing is by giving a pre-authorization consistent with the statute on anything that under that existing rubric is below $1,500. Okay. So the statute does not require it on an item-by-item basis.
Maybe I'm being a little fickle here, but two things. One, you know, you've got an inventory list that has to be kept up with, so that's one issue. And the second, sometimes these procedures are put into place to protect employees. And in my view, we're putting them out there. if you look at the last item on the policy.
I would take that to mean that if an employee tried to dispose of surplus property on his own without going through this policy.
I understand what you think it says, but if it was property that was valued over $1,500 and they didn't know, and they didn't make that determination, you put that person at risk because it wasn't declared surplus. It's a violation of the policy. And I'm just saying sometimes these things are to protect our employees. May be a nuisance. You know, but there's reason for it.
I'm guessing.
And I know no one is all knowing, but I mean, if you check your sources and you cross reference online, that you got to be close. And no one's trying to put anyone at risk. We have a bunch of clutter over there that needs to be taken care of, and it just increases the general manager's ability to get rid of it.
Your current approved policy now gives the general manager the $100 value or less for the majority of items, and it was approved to go up to $500 or less for the oil field apparatus.
Well, I can say, if you read the water code, it doesn't say except for or you're up. It says any piece of property, and that's just what I'm basing on. So that's
okay. We have a motion from Director Benson. And Kuhn, and a second from Director Benson. We have further discussion.
Is your question the dollar amount, or just the items aren't going to get listed properly?
Well, you're talking about public property,
right?
Okay, and public property is a fiduciary responsibility of the board. And the way it reads, when the board declares that it's surplus or able to be disposed of, it's made a determination, and that fulfills our duty as a board to fulfill that role. I see this as, you know, I didn't like the $100 one, okay? Mm-hmm. But, you know, and I go back to some of the issues I ran into in other public agencies where this was an issue, and it became a very critical issue with some of the employees, so. I'm old school, hard grain.
Well, I see the role of the board to also set policy and to designate authority down to the personnel who handle that. So in like manner, by your procurement policy, you give authorization to the purchasing agent to purchase.
We can designate, but we cannot give up our responsibility.
Well, we haven't. It's just by extension.
Well, go for it.
But
I'm fine. I'm just telling you, I'm opposed to it because I think that not only would put the employees, but I think it puts the board in a bad spot.
Okay. Further discussion? Questions? We have a motion from Director Kuhn and a second from Director Benson. Call for the vote. Item passes 3-1. Next up is action item 19, the purchase of equipment. There's two different purchases. One involves 13 forklifts from Toyota Lift Incorporated, and the other one is two lowboy type trailers from Harley Murray Incorporated. These items are located on page 100 and 106 of the agenda, and presenting today is Don Campbell. You turn the mic on, Don.
Where is it at? Where's the switch?
I think it's on.
It's automatic.
Is it on?
Yeah.
What you have before you this evening is a request to replace 13 forklifts that's assigned and used throughout the RID service area for maintenance and operation. In the past, this type of equipment was leased, and Fleet was given the grant, the approval to purchase this type of equipment in the future, and this is what this request is. And at one time, we had a total amount of 16 forklifts. In working with some of the end users, we've tried to accumulate and work together to minimize some of these purchases. The water department has went from 4 forklifts to 1, and the forklifts are located in different areas throughout the IID. This is equipment without rates, and it's kind of calculated in a matter where it's like a tool. I mean, it's these are equipment that's used on a daily basis.
Don, is this this is a lease of forklifts or a purchase?
These are purchases, sir.
Purchased.
Yes.
And are there any other forklifts that are supplied at the facilities other than the Toyota forklifts?
Toyota was the number one bidder when we leased these 3 years ago, and they're the number one bidder this go around also. We actually went through the competitive bid process and evaluated them, and they were the low bidder.
So this is a purchase rather than a lease?
Yes, sir.
And Don, just so I'm clear, these are new forklifts, not the 2009s that are listed, right?
Yes. I'm requesting approval to buy.
To exchange out.
Right. Yes, sir. Because the lease is due to complete in September. And as you know, with the ARB and the emission issue, what we would have to go through to try to maintain or keep these older forklifts.
Are they all diesel?
Yes, sir.
So we can't use natural gas?
Yeah, you can, but the problem is propane. Refueling them. I mean,
we don't have propane.
No, there's not a reliable source to refuel them.
Okay.
Mr. President, I'll make a motion to approve.
We have a motion. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second. I've got a couple questions. Don, the garage over there has a forklift, too. It has a Caterpillar forklift. Is that included in the overall?
That's not included in this, and that forklift is going to go away this year because it would have to be retrofitted.
So it'll go away, and it'll be replaced by one of these groups here?
What's going to happen with that one is we'll share one of the other forklifts in the store area.
So you're gonna consolidate down to
a reduction
in forklift size, and do we have any idea how many hours a month we're burning on these forklifts?
Well, I did a random number there, Mr. Desert. They're anywhere from it's kind of hard to calculate it by the use by the hour. Some of these forklifts have 600-800 hours on them, but they use them every day loading and unloading trucks and trailers and of that nature. So it's kind of hard to measure the use by the hours that's on them.
So that's 600-700 in a year or in total?
In total.
And how many years have we had them?
3 years.
So it's 300 hours a year?
It's an hour a day.
Why don't we just buy these?
Well, that was the comment I made. We thought about that, but if you buy these and then you'd have to retrofit them because they're diesel.
That's not very many hours.
I understand,
that's a lot,
sir,
of forklifts. How are they distributed through the organization?
Well, the biggest part of them are used in material and stores, unloading trucks and trailers here in La Quinta.
How many have in La Quinta, for example?
There's two in La Quinta.
Two in La Quinta?
Yes.
Okay, and what about the water department?
The water department has one. It's assigned to Western Division. There's one at the power dock. There's two at generation, and facilities has two, and the rest are at store.
I mean, there's not a way to park a couple of these units at the fueling bay and have both water and power.
Well, what we're doing
function right serviced by checking them out. I mean, that's an hour a day or less than an hour a day.
I don't want to speak for the end user, but what we've been doing is I've been talking with them, and we're looking at trying to consolidate some of these. And I know the request is for approval of 13, but we're looking at maybe reducing two of these. And that language is in the agreement when we go out to bid that we can increase or decrease the order. So we are looking at that.
Well, we're taking action on a purchase, though, today of 13 forklifts, aren't we?
Yes. Because the time frame of the lease is so close, we kind of had to move, Mr. Desert. And if the board would like, we'll bring that information back to you. if we decrease the order. That way you know. I mean, we want to be transparent with doing our business. But it's, again, it's the end user use these machines every day.
I just would like to say that in every, well, I don't know about every business, but in my business, you know, I have a backhoe. I don't use it every day, but damn, when I need it, I've got it, and we use it. And you can't run this business, this one, without forklifts. And you sure as hell don't want anybody getting hurt trying to do it by hand. And so there are going to be areas where you're going to have low use. But just to reiterate, these old ones are going to be retrofitted if you buy them, because they're not going to be compliant with the Air Resources ARB. Board.
And that's one.
No one's talking about buying the old ones, but there's just, well, we'll just take action on it. We've had some concern about the hours, and I just would encourage the board members
and,
to go
and,
out
and I can certainly understand,
take account about how many,
because, you know, I mean, on my laser scrapers, we run the hell out of them, but the others, backhoe, the water truck, the dump truck, we just don't put a lot of hours on.
And one of the things we talked about was purchasing versus
lease. Yes, that's one of the reasons.
Okay, yeah. What was the lease amount for these?
3 years. It was a 3-year agreement.
And yes. What was the amount?
Yeah. The average forklift, the 8,000 pound rated was $640 a month, I believe.
$640.
But that's with the service agreement.
Is that because it seems low, but is that because of the low hours?
No, that was just a comparative price that Toyota offered the IID.
And that's for a 3-year lease. And what do you project the lifetime to be of these we purchase? If they only use 600 or 700 hours a year, they should start growing whiskers after a while.
A year and 3 years.
Yeah.
Yeah, for 3 years, yeah.
And that's one of the reasons we're recommending to get away from the lease on certain equipment. But a forklift is a unique piece of equipment. It's something that I mean, you have to have. And in our line of business, they use them multiple times. It may be not for very many hours, but they use them every day.
I'm thinking if you buy them, you can keep them longer.
Right.
But if you lease them, the lease is coming up. So you either buy those or you give them back. So it kind of got their back against the wall. Now, I'm not for letting stuff sit around and, you know, and not be used, but you can't run this company without forklift. You can't do it.
Well, I think Don knows where I'm coming from on this. You know, we've had other equipment we turn back at 3,000 yeah. hours and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and, you know, if I was in need of equipment, I'd be the first in line to purchase those things. I mean, it's almost like new, and we're turning them back.
Yeah, Mr. Hanks, I totally agree with you. I operate on the other side at all, too, so I know what you're talking about when people expect me to be prudent with their monies. But, you know, another issue we have, too, and I'm saying this in a constructive way, we don't really have an unloading dock at headquarters. Sometimes it makes it difficult. Sometimes they need multiple forklifts to unload trucks and trailers and stuff like that, and that's another issue that we're faced with.
So what would the cost of a unloading dock be?
Well, to build that in headquarters yard.
I put one in for $40,000, a double dock.
Okay. I couldn't answer that.
Okay.
You'll have to have a forklift get in the truck, get it off.
You got 13 of them.
Yeah.
Okay, we have a. We're going to handle these items separately, items A and B. The first item will be the 13 forklifts. We have a motion and a second. Any further questions or discussion? Call for the vote. So it's a 2-2 vote on that. So we're going to have to look at extending those leases and bring this item back for further discussion, Mr. Kelly. And so the next item is the two lowboy trailers.
Yes. The two lowboy trailers are used by the wire department to haul heavy equipment throughout the IID service area.
And are they just worn out, or is it the miles on them?
They're just worn out and miles. And what happens is that type of equipment and the terrain that they use, they get multiple cracks and fractures, and it just wears them out from hauling that heavy equipment out on the ditch banks.
How old are the trailers?
I think they're 7 years old, both of them.
Okay. And then these trailers, if we take action on this, they'll be declared surplus, and we'll be auctioning them off?
Yes, sir.
some of the farmers might like to have access to these type of a low boy trailer?
Yes, sir.
And are these, do we have various sizes of low boy trailers? Are these large ones that will handle everything?
Yeah, these are large ones that will handle everything.
And how many of these do we have total in fleet?
We have two right now of this size, the ones that I'm recommending to replace.
Okay. Board, further questions or discussion? We have a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve.
We have a motion from Director Benson to approve. Is there a second?
I'll second.
And a second from Director Kuhn. Further discussion?
I just had a quick question. I saw there was only one person who was the bid. Was it sent to multiple trailer companies?
Yeah, we sent them to multiple trailers, and Murray Trailer was the one that responded to the bid. It's usually Murray or Cozad, and for some reason Murray was the only one. And they're just right down the street from one another in Stockton. So.
Okay.
So we have a motion and a second. Call for the vote. Item passes 4-0. Thank you, Mr. Campbell. Mr. Campbell, we're got rid of four water trucks. We replaced four water trucks, and I think we're replacing quite a few Sand Harrow pickups.
Yes.
Have those water trucks come up for auction yet?
No, the new ones are being built. It's in process right now. We haven't received the new ones yet.
Okay, so could you or Donna or someone make an effort to get a message out to the Farm Bureau and Colab veg growers when those Sand Harrow pickups and the water trucks become available
for
auction?
Yeah, the half-ton pickups that the board approved, they were delivery on those last week.
Okay.
So we should have that delivery completed here in the next couple of days. But the new water trucks that was ordered are being built as we speak, so it'll probably still be a few months before those are delivered.
Okay.
I mean, the truck's already built. They build the tank and the pumps and all that stuff.
Right. What happens is the factory drop ships the chassis to the builder, and they build the tank and put the sprayers and pumps and that stuff on. But if I may mention on the forklifts, that lease is due to complete in September, so we need to get together on that.
Okay.
Don,
I had a quick question, and it related to the water trucks, but I think it came up, maybe this isn't the right time to do it, but that our water trucks spend a lot of time filling up at the canals, and the question was, could we ever set up some of those rapid discharge stations out in the areas to just load trucks quicker?
Drop tanks,
there you go.
Yeah, the water trucks that we have self-loading pumps on them, so they're not...
I know, but it's still 10, 15 minutes to fill some of those. No?
Uh-uh. It got, well, how's this? Mine is 4 minutes, and it's 4,000 gallon.
Yeah. Okay.
All right, it's great.
But we do have, in headquarters yard, we have one of those, so at least they can get started that way. Thank you guys very much.
Thank you, Don. Okay, our last action item today is action item 20, is approval of an amendment to service agreement with Buck Consultants to provide services overseeing the management of the 401A and 457B IID plans. Page 108 of your agenda, and presenting today is Mr. DeVoy.
Good afternoon. Dan DeVoy, Manager of Human Resources and Loss Control. We're asking your approval today to extend our service agreement with Buck Consultants for 3 years for a new not-to-exceed amount of $143,000. They're currently assisting us in our submission with IRS's voluntary compliance program to ensure that both our 401A plan and our 457 deferred comp plan are in fully compliant with IRS requirements regarding plan amendments and periodic restatement of our plan.
So, Dan, is there any other information that this board needs to be aware of with this Buck Consultant contract? How many years have we been utilizing this?
We've been utilizing them since we converted our plan, our retirement plan, from a voluntary or from a defined benefit plan to a voluntary contribution plan.
And then is there going to be a Somerset
defined contribution
plan, Somerset date for this activities?
We did our first submission for the 401A plan back in April, I believe. And in talking to our friends at Buck, it takes anywhere from 9 to 18 months to get through that plan. And then we'll also do a submission for the 457 plan as well.
In your service agreement, down at the bottom, you have here that the 213 budget has 33,000. Is that a typo or?
It's not a typo. It's $33,000 that we have allocated for the next 3 years, so it would be $33,000 per year. So there's currently $33,000 as a budget line item that we would like to transfer to this agreement for this year.
Okay, but Patty, you have here $44,000.
The first agreement, when this agreement was drafted, this is the first amendment we're doing. This amendment that has $44,000 expired January 21st of this year. It expired while I was out on medical leave. That's why I'm looking to extend it to continue doing the work that we have to do to put all the plans in compliance.
You have sufficient funds beyond the $33,000 covered? Or is that
right now we paid them $17,000, so there's an outstanding invoice of $16,000. The $33,000, Director Hanks, is also including some of the business that they currently provide for us, which is the Quadro administration. That's the separation of the division of assets when there's a divorced couples. We use them to do the actuarial evaluation.
I was under the assumption that you were asking for $44,000 a year, but you're talking about that's for the 3 years.
Right.
Yes.
Okay, I'm with you now.
It's $33,000 a year.
It's $33,000 a year.
I had a question. We're not asking him to do a review of the fund lineup, are we?
We will be as part of this. As we go forward, that will assist you in your fiduciary duties to the plan to have an independent set of eyes to review our fund lineup on an annual basis. So we would plan on having them out here in October to help with that.
All right, because in looking at their schedule of fees, it just seems kind of expensive, $1,000 per fund to review it up to 23 funds. Maybe we should cut down on the numbers so we're not spending so much money to...
Well, this would be the first time in about 4 years that Buck would actually come out here. The person who prepared the estimate was being a little aggressive in the cost of the fees.
Okay.
We do not have, we have 21 fees. So the process is moving
forward. 21 funds.
21 funds, sorry.
Okay.
The process is moving forward. Vanguard will come and do their annual report, present, and then Buck will come and review what they presented and provide you guys guidance on the funds.
So they crunch the numbers on Vanguard's work.
Right. And the goal is that the first year they would physically come out here, and then in the following years, we would look for guidance with you if you wanted them to actually come out every year and do this, or if you wanted them to do it virtually.
I mean, isn't Vanguard an accredited investment firm to where we should trust their numbers, or can we use our in-house people to crunch those numbers?
I mean, at the direction of the board, we can. What right now, what happens is that the 401A plan is being it's audited every year by Moss Adams.
Okay.
And we just finished that. I assisted in that. I didn't.
They're just looking at the lineup of all the stocks or the funds that people invest in, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
But the actual audit of numbers is being done by Moss.
Okay.
Does Buck provide this service for any other agencies locally, for like, say, for Imperial County?
I'm not sure.
They have their own building. Retirement fund.
Yeah, I know. Okay, further discussion or questions, board? We have a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion from Director Benson and a second from Director Hanks. Further questions? Call for the vote. Item passes 4-0. We'll take a short 5-10 minute recess and come back and finish up our information agenda.